Hey Potters, welcome to episode 180 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. I guess that makes this the opposites episode, so don't take anything that we say seriously. Not that you should ever take anything we say seriously.
I was going to say, you should probably not take Amber seriously, but take me super seriously. Hey.
I can agree with that. Although sometimes I am serious.
Sometimes.
Yes. But at any rate, we are here to talk about all things cosplay, as we do every other week here on the podcast. We would like to welcome our new listeners to the show. If you have not heard us before, we are Val and Amber. We are your humble hosts, humble most of the time. And we talk about all sorts of things, interviews, and we do reviews on products. And we talk about the things that you guys are talking about in cosplay news, as well as showing off the stuff that we do. So, first and foremost, do you have any updates?
Of course I have updates. Hang on. Switch over here.
Show and tell time.
It's show and tell time. I've been making cheese.
It's chainmail. Yeah. It's European 4-in-1.
Had to do and that. I had to make the noise. So I've been working on chainmails ever since the last episode, and I've been doing so much of it that I'm actually almost done with the two halves of my belt. It's kind of scary. I literally just have three lines on this one, and then I'm done. And I can just make the rest of the belt. It'll be great. So this is for my Game of Thrones costume. I am very determined to get it done this year. I was hoping to get it done before the final season airs, but that's like mid-April, and that's not going to happen because there's a ton of embroidery I got to do. But I'm going to put some effort into it. I really want to get this costume done. And this was really a lot of fun. I have never done chainmail before. I'm going to zoom in a little bit. So I did a lot of research, a lot of reading, watched a ton of tutorials because I was very, very unsure of myself. And when I figured out a system that worked best for me, I was just able to kind of go with the groove. You find a place where you're just like, okay, I can just keep doing this and then have something on in the background, watched a couple of movies, caught up on the Marvel Universe. I did a lot of that. And this just kind of came together out of nowhere. It was great. So this has been my project for the last 2 weeks, and I've been really happy with the results. It's going to look really cool when I finish the front and back piece, that's for sure.
So clearly by the jingle, those are not plastic rings. What material is that made of?
They are actually aluminum. I opted to not go with steel. I wanted to have something that was a little bit lightweight because I'm me and I try to go for comfort. Even though it's going to be breaking that 100% realism, it's not going to be exact to what they have on the show. I'm trying to be, you know, okay, the actress probably only wore it for like 2 or 3 hours. I'm trying to wear this for like 6 to 8 hours. I don't want to get weighed down, even though it's sitting on my waist. So I went with aluminum. And these are really, really nice rings. I'm very surprised by the quality. I haven't found the crappy one yet. It was, came in a bag of 1500. So, but I like it. I'm happy with it.
Bit of trivia for you guys. A steel chainmail shirt can weigh in excess of 20 pounds.
That's exactly why I decided not to use steel.
Indeed. Okay, guys. Trivia time. For those of you who have been watching the show, what am I going to show you for my cosplay update?
Stuffs.
What do I always have?
You have things and stuff. It's a pile of paper.
It's a pile of fabric. I always have piles of fabric because a lot of what I do is textiles now. No, I finally finished retracing a new set of patterns. This is actually for the first cosplay I'm going to work on this year, which is Deedlit from Record of Lodoss War. Yes, I finally chose a project and I'm actually sitting down and doing it. Yay!
Woo!
Yes, so this is my set of bodysuit patterns, which oddly enough, some of the pieces are oddly shaped. And I'm not quite sure how to assemble them because it doesn't look like... So if you were to make clothing by taking apart another piece of clothing and then basically just ripping it apart for pattern pieces, like you'd expect a swimsuit type pattern to look a certain way. Well, these don't look anything like I would picture taking a swimsuit apart at all. So this is Riddle's bodysuit pattern, incidentally. I'm kind of going through... So if this doesn't work, I'll try Yaya's. And if this doesn't work, there's actually a third one out now that I will try. So hopefully between this and a full circle skirt, I will actually have a fairly adaptable costume where I'm not worried about people seeing my undies that I can sit down in and be extraordinarily comfortable because as some of you guys may know, I have no summer costumes at all. And this is a very light sleeveless tunic type costume. So nice and comfy. That will be my first order of business this year. And I know that the next one I'm going to work on after this one is going to be Brave Lynn from Fire Emblem. So I already have, those are the only two on my agenda, by the way. I'm not making any plans because I don't want to be disappointed. I don't want to put too much on my plate and pressure myself. So I'm just having very simple, easy to work on, very comfortable costumes. No armor. Yes, yes, I know. But, you know, sometimes you just have to put that stuff off, you know, let the youngins do it.
You know what? The nice thing about it, especially because we've become cosplay elders at this point, like yes. you work at your own pace. You get things done when you want to get them done. You know, you don't have any restrictions. You don't have to pressure yourself. It's just like, hey, costume's ready to go. Let's wear it. It's nice. It's very relaxing.
Plus, at this point in my life, I'm retired from competition. I have not been invited as a guest anywhere. So realistically, I'm not trying to impress anybody. So there's really no point in making these really impressive armor-laden costumes because, you know, they're not comfortable and I'm not trying to impress anybody. So I may as well just make something that I like being around in and that it's really easy to wear for press duties or you running cosplay things, contests.
Yeah, you make things that you're going to be happy with, you know? That's what matters at the end of the day.
Yep. All right. So that is all that I have for my cosplay updates. So let's move on into our next segment. Val was on vacation this past weekend.
I don't know if it counts as vacation.
Sort of.
If vacation is driving 6 hours to San Antonio in the evening and then spending a Saturday in San Antonio and then driving up first thing Sunday morning, that you okay. Vacation?
Vacation.
That's
for those
better.
Who are listening to the podcast, I used air quotes.
It's lots of air quotes because that's... Yes. 100% more accurate.
Yes, Val was at PAX South.
I was at PAX South, and I know that a couple of people who are watching us right now as we're recording live were also there at PAX South because I ran into you. Yay. It was good compared to previous years because at this point I've attended all the PAX Southeast? PAXies? Is there a plural to that? I don't think so.
PAXes?
PAXes? Sure, we'll go with that one. So I've been to all of the PAX Souths that have been made available. This year, we decided to just do one day instead of doing the whole three-day shebang. And I'm kind of glad that we did because you could do everything at PAX South in one day. PAX South is in this very weird position where it doesn't really quite know where it wants to be. It's trying to be a little bit of everything. It's trying to be East and West. It's trying to be Australia. It's trying to be PAX Unplugged, but it's also trying to be like a relaxing atmosphere. And it's just, it doesn't really work for what it's trying to do. If it was just an indie only gaming con, and I think if they just catered all the content towards that, cool, like go with it, roll with it. But since they're trying to be like, oh, here's some indie stuff, and then here's some tabletop, and then here's Capcom, and then here's Sony, but they're not showing big things. But oh, we also have the music room. So it's like we're having a competition with MAGFest, and you're just like, okay, let's take it down a notch and reevaluate what we want to try and do. Because it just makes things too chaotic, but there's not enough content going on. Because I really didn't sit in on any of the panels this year because nothing looked appealing. We didn't go to any of the gaming rooms outside of the expo hall because, again, nothing was really appealing. It was just like we could walk the entire show floor in a day. We were able to see and play everything that we wanted to. Without any trouble. So it was like, cool. So if anything, it's a good place to kind of relax and chill, meet new people. That's always fun. There was some cosplay. The bit that I did see, it was pretty light. There were a lot of really nice, cool costumes. But again, there's that trend of people doing a lot more casual stuff, things that are easy to walk around in, to sit, so you don't have to worry about like bringing these huge mechs into the expo hall. Though some people did that with an Overwatch group and they're very, very crazy. Please keep that outside because you're just causing traffic jams. The cool stuff, guys, but let's just be reasonable here. But really, I mean, it hasn't changed since it started. And I just have this weird feeling that if they don't figure out what they want to do with it, the attendance is going to steadily just keep dropping. And people who do want to go will probably only show up for a day. And that's they really want people to kind of stick around for 3 days because then you spend more money. Hey, I mean, that's kind of the point of it. I'm going to read one of Allie's comments. She said that she thought it would be bigger. Yeah, it is. South is much, much smaller compared to East and West. East, you feel like you're in a sardine can, needless to say. And West, you have to go all 4 days in West to truly experience it, because that sucker encompasses not only the entire three floors of the convention center, but also the humongous hotel that's next door, plus four other hotels that are located around Seattle. It's big, and you need to be able to experience all of it in 4 days. And then her other comment is lots of cosplay not related to gaming, which is 100% true too, because that's not something you see at the other PAX events, is that we got a lot of people who are dressed up as anime and superhero characters that weren't in video games, and it kind of stands out. And I think it's because they don't quite know what the PAX atmosphere is like, because I hear that a lot too. They're like, oh, this is not like an anime convention. No, it's not. It's an expo for video games. There's a big difference. Not to say that there's anything wrong with them cosplaying whatever they want. They can do what they want. Cool. It's just, it's very obvious that they're there for one reason, and they get there and they're like, oh, this is not what I expected at all. Like, no, it's not. I do have a feeling, though, they're probably going to keep it the same location. It's in the San Antonio Convention Center. It's a big convention center, and they have plenty of room to grow there because they don't even use a fraction of the rooms. Like, they have the big expo hall floor, a couple of rooms on the second floor, and a couple on the third floor, but there's way more space on the second floor that they could totally eat up. And they did the first year. Don't know why they haven't done it since then, but, you know, what do I know? Hey, if I do go back, might try flying down so I don't have to drive again, because I spent like 8 hours in the car on Friday. I really don't want to do that again.
Texas is big, y'all.
Texas be big, y'all. Very, very big. And I don't know. If I do go back, it'll just be another one day thing, because I haven't seen anything that makes me go, ooh, I need to go back for 3 days so that I can totally experience everything. You can do it all in one day. Plus, they have all the panels online. So you can watch them again on Twitch without a problem.
I did. I exactly. Streamed them live.
Really, the only fun panel, we did sit on one of them, which was the Acquisitions Incorporated. That was great. I will say, I think compared to the other AC Incorporateds that I've sat in on, the Texas crowd seems to be the loudest crowd and the most involved. We really get into it, which is great. And there were a couple of really fun indie games. I'm going to be working on a blog post to put on my personal gaming blog to kind of detail them and give more insight, because there were a lot of fun games to play there, but you only really need to spend a day and you're good. Cosplay is always excellent, though. Hey, thumbs up. Double thumbs up for Texans, because we know our cosplay. We be good.
This whole time I've had this image in my head of PAX South as that little kid that's in mom's heels trying to imitate the older, bigger cons that have been around for longer, like East and Prime.
Mm-hmm.
Because South is new. For those who don't know, PAX South hasn't been around near as long as East or Prime, which is now known as West, or maybe the other way around. It may have formerly been West and now is Prime.
No, it's Prime, now it's West.
Okay. It's only been around, I think this was its second year.
Oh, no.
Second or third?
Like year five.
I'm sorry. So having been around for, you know, such a short time, they haven't really had a chance to kind of grow into what I think they want to become yet. So I just have this image of like little kid in mom's heels. I don't want to grow up.
Nice. Oh, tear.
I know.
You made me sad, Panda.
Rip.
Rip. Super rip.
We still have our childhoods.
But which is funny, though, because South for its first year had a higher attendance rate than East or West when they first started. And I think it was higher than Australia, too. So it's got the potential. And we have so many independent developers within the South. Like I said, if they just made this the indie PAX, I think there would be set. They just need to cater the content to be indie PAX. And then they've got what they need.
There's just a really, there's a big gaming community in general in Texas.
Ooh, good gravy, yes.
Not just video games, but also tabletop games, card games, all that.
at least half of the expo hall, it was much larger this year compared to last year, was just tabletop gaming. It was just straight up tabletop. It was massive.
Also, thank you guys for all the Lodos love earlier. I am reading the comments and it makes me very happy. I've actually already worn Deedlit before. It was the first cosplay I ever made when I first went to Project Acon, the first time I ever went to a convention. It's the first time I had ever sewn something by myself. And I would like to remedy a lot of that. I have learned a lot since I wore that costume.
It's you
many
revisiting.
Years ago. Yes. Making it much better quality and fitting better.
You've learned so much in all this time.
Yes, I have learned a lot. And speaking of learning a lot, I have learned a lot about a new product, which is not new anymore, but it was new to us. When we were at ArlingCon last year, we actually came across the TNT cosplay booth, and they had product. They had a lot of product. The first time that we ended up seeing them was at AllCon. I think it was the same year prior to that. And when they had a booth, they didn't have as much product. They mostly had foam, which they are very well known for. And they have a lot of different thicknesses of foam. And now they have tubing. So you can make all sorts of chain effects and all sorts of really cool mechanical steampunk stuff. But they have this wonderful product called HexFlex, which is this thing right here. Well, right side up so you guys can read it. There you go. HexFlex. And no, we are not sponsored by them. We bought these ourselves so that we could show this to you guys. What this is kind of a sealer, primer, mix-in all-in-one. It will make paint flexible when I say mix-in. So it's almost like a liquid latex. However, this does not tell me what sort of materials are in it, so I don't even know if this is actually made of latex. But basically, it comes in several different colors. So I'm going to see if I can pop this open, or if it's going to end up being like those glue tubes to where when you've poured some of it in the cap and then you try and close it and it basically glues itself shut.
Well, while you're doing that,
I suspect has happened.
I'm going to go ahead and share what the product looks like in the multiple colors, because it also comes in a clear form, which you can use it to mix with other paints. So that way it kind of becomes your own base paint.
Yep. And that's actually the kind that we bought. We bought the clear, even though they actually had several other varieties there. Yeah, there's no way I'm getting my bottle open at this point. It glued itself shut.
Oh, no.
That's all right, because basically all I was going to do is to pour some in the cap to show you guys. This has actually a slightly more liquid consistency than Mod Podge. So if you guys have ever worked with Mod Podge, it's not quite as thick. So it doesn't have that sort of glue-like consistency that's basically just water and glue. Hey, I got the cap off. Yay.
It did
actually glue itself shut. Oh man, don't pour this in the cap. So let me pop the bubble that's at the top and not in my face. There we go. All right, so I'm gonna pour a little bit of this in the cap so you guys can see this, hopefully on cam. Yoink. So you can see that this flows really well. It's got a very, very liquid viscosity to it. Why that's important is that they'll tell you that you can use as many or as few coats of this as you need, and that one coat is basically enough. I can attest to this. Mm-hmm. One coat is actually enough. I have used it both as a primer and as a sealant. What I ended up doing is on this particular prop, which this is the top half of the light-up staff that I actually took to TRF, this was both primed and sealed with HexFlex. And you may not be able to see the texture as well on cam, but this actually has a little bit of a leather-like consistency, which surprised me. So that if you're wanting to, say, make leather armor, and you don't actually want to make it out of leather because not everybody has access to it or has the skill to work with it, you can use craft foam and then seal it with HexFlex, with the clear HexFlex, and it looks just like leather. It's a really cool effect. And I can attest that when you seal craft foam with this stuff, you can bend the craft foam a full 180 degrees and it will not crack, which is exactly what I did on the tip of my staff here. Is I had to bend the craft foam all the way around in a 360 degree circle. There was no cracking. And it was a single layer of HexFlex. I actually ended up doing a second layer, but that was more for my own personal security than any defect in the product. It's really solid. I will say that when it goes on initially with your paintbrush, even though it has that liquid viscosity to it, it's surprisingly thick when you brush it on. And it comes out whitish. So don't be surprised. The actual product says clear on the bottle and it dries clear. But when it comes out initially, it is white. At least the version that is marked is clear. So don't be surprised when you see that. It does help you see where you've got the coverage so that you make sure that you don't miss any spots. It dries very quickly. They do recommend that you wait a full 24 hours, and I heartily recommend this because I will tell you from experience that if you try and touch it before that 24 hours, even if it is dry, you will leave fingerprints, which are very hard to get out of the final product. And then you end up having to put another coat on because you were a dummy and touched it before they said you were supposed to touch it. It doesn't require any special tools to work with. A simple paintbrush is fine. It washes out with water. Even if you get it all over your hands, you can just wash your hands with water and it's just fine. A bottle this size, which here's my hand for reference, so it's about the size of my entire palm, costs you about $5. And obviously, a little goes a long way. So this, I don't even think I used a capful for my entire prop. You can probably do a full suit of armor with this. Now, granted, I don't think you'll be able to do more than that, but you should be able to at least get a suit of armor or a good sized chunk of armor with just one bottle. And it will last you a long time if you don't do armor. I have used it in cool weather. I have used it in warm weather. It doesn't seem to matter. It's a very flexible product. I really like this stuff. I like it much better than Mod Podge. If this wasn't, you know, twice as expensive as Mod Podge, I would probably use it much more often for all of my projects, like not just prop making, I'd use it for everything. But for right now, I basically use Mod Podge on things that are static or stiff, anything that doesn't have to move. And then I use HexFlex on anything that has to have any sort of flexibility to it. Man, if I had only had this stuff when I've made all my armor, all my hard armor back in the past, it would have made my life so much easier. I love this stuff. So, of course, it is, again, called HexFlex. It is about $5 for 250-gram bottle, which is also 240 milliliters. You can find it at TNT Cosplay Supply. And, of course, you can find their store online, or they have a physical shop front in Irving, Texas. You are always welcome to visit them at conventions. I believe they will be at AllCon this year. So if you guys see us at AllCon, you might stop by and see if they have a booth and talk them up.
And while I was researching and getting photos for said HexFlex, they do have an expanded product line coming out, and there's definitely other vendors that now carry it too. So if you just Google it, or even if you go to their main page, you can find a number of vendors that are probably much more easily convenient located near you.
Yes. It doesn't have to be TNT Cosplay Supply. They just happen to be local to us. Yeah, but it's a very cool product. I highly recommend it. Any kind of prop making, armor making. It doesn't smell, which is also a good thing. Man, Mod Podge smells.
Well, I mean, Mod Podge smells like glue. What do you think it is?
Well, yes, but HexFlex doesn't. I mean, it has a slight odor to it. It has a slight odor to it. It's not as strong as Mod Podge. Right.
Yeah.
I don't have to take it outside to work with it.
Exactly. It's not like you need a full-on respirator.
Right. Given the number of stinky chemicals we work with in prop making, it's always nice to have one that you don't have to wear a respirator.
I will say when I used it, because I used it for my Slime King crown, I did do it both ways. I did it where I added it as a primer, but then for the colors on the inside of the crown, I did mix it with the paint. The mixing with the paint, it looked great. When I tried it with the metallics, it was just kind of it lost some of the luster and the shine. So if you want to work with metallic paint, I'd recommend that you use it as a primer first, then you paint the metallics on top of it.
That's a really good point that I had forgotten. If you have shiny metallics, this will make them matte. It gives it a matte finish. So if you're looking for that mirror shine, like a sword blade, you're not going to want to use this stuff as a sealant. I mean, there's nothing wrong with it. It gives it a clear coat, but it will take away that mirror shine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so definitely use it as a primer, then paint on top of it, but then get something else to seal it. Otherwise, you're going to lose some of that shine.
Right. Yep. But that's all I got.
I think that's all we has.
Ken has more? No, not until next episode, guys.
Sorry,
but to keep you fulfilled until our next episode, you can always join us chatting with us on any of our social media, which of course you can always find here.
I was ready this time.
And we would love it if you guys would join us on our Discord, where we are talking about all sorts of things cosplay, including at the moment, sequels to movies and television shows, which has nothing to do with cosplay, but that's because we also have a non-cosplay chat channel too.
It has everything to do with cosplay. What are you talking about? We make sequels to our costumes.
Well, to be fair, we do like to watch things and listen to things in the background while we're working on cosplay. So sometimes it's nothing more than just a, hey, what are you listening to while you're working on cosplay right now? So I guess, yes, it does still have to do with cosplay.
It's helped me find some really entertaining shows. So,
but of course, if you guys have recommendations for shows that we should be watching when working on cosplay, or if you'd just like to share what you're listening to as you're working on your latest project, we'd also invite you guys to email us. podcast@cosspod.org, where of course you will get an answer from both of us individually because we're just weird like that.
Thank you, Amber.
Anytime. I try really hard.
I know you do.
At any rate, we hope you guys are having a wonderful time working on your cosplay. We will see you guys next episode in 181. Happy cosplaying, everybody.
Bye, everybody.